I am Dr. Erdi Fadrigilan. I am a cardiac electrophysiologist, and my specialty deals with heartbeat and its abnormalities. This is the fourth part of the video series on basic ECG. So if you haven't seen the first three videos, the links are posted in the description box below. And if you like similar contents, please consider subscribing to my channel, share and like the video, and hit the notification bell so you will get updated.
That when we say P wave and the normal P wave, we actually refer to the P waves or atrial activation coming from the sinus node impulse formation. So when we talk about atrial rhythm and we say it's sinus, you need to look at the P wave morphology and nothing else. In fact, sometimes when I do rounds and I ask fellows to define what a sinus sinus rhythm is, they would say it's a normal looking P wave followed by a normal looking QRS with a normal PR interval. Well, that is normal sinus rhythm. But we just talk about sinus rhythm, we actually just limit ourselves to the morphology of the P wave and what's the origin of the atrial rhythm. So we concentrate on the P wave only. So when we say sinus P wave, we actually refer to a configuration in the ECG that the P wave is positive in lead 2, also in lead 1, because lead 1 is a left lead, and we know that the activation of the atria will be from the right to left. So leads which are coming from the left will be, or towards the left from the right, will record positive leads. So that would be 1 AVL and the lateral precordial leads. And the generation is likewise from superior to inferior, because again, the sinus node is located superiorly, such that AVF would likewise record a positive deflection, and V1 will record a biphasic deflection. And this is the reason why. This is basically how the atria are activated. Again, the sinus node will be the generation or the origin of the cardiac impulse. It will first go into the right atrium, and V1 is here. So it's going to be towards V1, producing a positive initial deflection. Then it will go to the Bachmann's bundle towards the left, now towards away. So the terminal deflection in V1 would now actually be negative. That's why in V1, sinus P wave are normally biphasic. Again, the general vector is going to be superior, going down to the AV node towards the direction of lead 2. So it is always positive in lead 2. Okay. How about the normal QRS complex? As you can see here, the normal QRS complex, again, is less than 0.12 second because the activation of the right and left ventricles are simultaneous. You will see here that the activation as well is going from left to right and superior to inferior. So the axis will be going downwards with positive leads 2, 3, and AVF. So it should always be in normal axis, positive in lead 1, and positive in AVF, and positive in lead 2. Because this is how they are being activated. Now, you might wonder in the precordial leads, let's go back to that, regarding the progression, that in the V1, you actually have a small r, with a deeper S becoming taller R, shallower S. As it transitions, this will be the transition point. Well, there will be R and S already becoming nearly equal, and it transitions to a bigger R to a smaller S in that of the lateral precordial leads. And here is how they are generated. I told you before that the His bundle will actually pierce part of the septum. It will go to the left, then go back to the right. So the initial QRS would actually be left to right in the part of the septum, producing the small r in V1 and the septal Q wave in V6. Okay, now this is quite important. This is normal, could be pathological in patients with myocardial infarction, and could be lost abnormally in patients with left bundle branch block. So that is one of the criteria. So that's why we look at this one. Now the second will be the bigger part of the myocardium being activated, will be that of towards the septum, towards both the right and the left ventricles, as you will see here. And the vectors would actually be going right to left, superiorly and inferiorly, creating the big the deep S in V1 because it's away from it, and the big R in V6 because it's towards from that. Okay, so that's how they are normally generated. The basal posterior part of the ventricle, the left ventricle, would be the last activated, and that will be reflected by the second but shallower S wave in V6, which is corresponding to a smaller amplitude R prime in that of V1. So the normal ST segment, we're done with the QRS, the normal ST segment should be isoelectric in leads. And again, it is at the level of the TP segment, as you can see here. So this is the TP segment, and it's isoelectric with the ST segment and the J point. The J point, by the way, is the junction between the QRS and that of the ST segment. So it marks the beginning of the ST segment and the end of the QRS. Now, in general, the T waves will have a polarity similar to the net polarity of the QRS deflection. So if you have lead one, for example, we know that the net polarity is positive, then T waves should be positive as well. That would be similar with AVF, hence a positive T wave in AVF, which should normally be positive. AVR, on the other hand, would record a net negative QRS, hence the negative QRS, and the lateral precordial leads would actually record positive T wave as well. They could be variable. They could be negative in leads V1 because, again, of that, we sometimes call it juvenile T waves, and it could be negative in lead 3 as well, and that could be a normal variant in patients. So we talked about how the ECGs are recorded, how the waveforms are picked up by the ECG, how they are generated in the normal heart. And when you have measured that everything is normal, the PR segment, the P wave duration, the PR interval, the QRS duration, the QT interval, both assessed and corrected, and you look at the morphology, all the criteria are normal. You have an ST segments, which are isoelectric, and even the J point, then you sign it out as a normal sinus rhythm, a normal ECG tracing.